Hey everybody, my name is Benjamin Arnaud, aka Bungie. And today, once again, we're going to Code Motion Box the video Brother. Or Brother, depends on how you pronounce it. So thank you for being here once again. It's been quite a few days since the last stream, and we're going to start right away. I'm going to do a brief recap of everything I did in the past days so you can understand where we're at. And then we're going to proceed to some coding and some design, since I'm designing by coding most of the time. So let's do it. So previously on this stream, the last episode was the Ben code extracting. So what that means is that I previously extracted a bencode file and retrieved the video file inside of it. So instead of talking about it, let's review that. Now, first of all, in the last few days, I've renamed backend bencode to backend torrent. And the reason for that is because, let me lower the sound a little bit here. The reason for that is because the backend bencode, the backend I'm writing, is not supposed to extract any bencode file. What it's supposed to do instead is just being an efficient backend to extract video files from a bencode file, and that's exactly what we're doing here. Here we're just extracting the name of the bencode content so that we can pretty much assign it to the playlist, and then we're extracting path here. And so the objective of this backend is really to extract a torrent as fast as possible in order to play it. That's the reason why I've renamed it backend torrent. So today is the episode 4. I'm naming episode afterwards, so for now there's no title, and since everything you see here is real and live, I don't know yet what I'm going to do exactly. That's the reason why I'm not going to name it right away. I haven't thought, I don't know what will happen today. So today I know that we're the 31 of May. And that's it. Now, unlike the last time where I was pretty much very busy the entire week, this time I had the time to code a little bit the last few days and on my Saturday. So let's review what I did. Let's go on GitHub/Bungie, which is my account here. Let's reset this to default. So, if you take a look at my logs, I'm not sure if we can see that. Yeah, I did a bunch of commits in Motionbox and Sky. Now, lots of them are still not pushed because I need to review them before deploying them. So I'm not sure what we'll see here. But, you know, add playlist parser. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I haven't pushed the code yet. But anyway, what I wanted to say is that you can go to my page and review everything that I'm doing. Everything that I code in this stream is going to be pushed on GitHub. GitHub is a mirror of my repositories. So yeah, if you just want to check the code and see what we're doing and even play with it, try to compile it or review things, everything is there. The thing that I coded previously on stream are there. So I think that adds another layer of interactivity with that stream, is that not only can you see me, can you hear and can you see my thought process, but then you can go online and check the sources for yourself. Now, another thing which I did in the last few days is also fix my website. There was an issue with the mailing. Long story short, Mandrill, which I was using to send mail, has gone paid, is becoming a paid module of another thing. So I switched to another service, which is called Mailgun, and for now I'm on it. And it seems to be working fine, and the website seems okay as far as I'm concerned. So one other thing that I wanted to say here is, first of all, go check it out if you haven't, if you didn't do it yet. You can pretty much get an explanation of what Motionbox is. And if you go on the About page, there's a little bit of a glimpse of what my philosophy here is. So you can read a bunch of things. There's the page in Motionbox. You can get it right away and download it. It's as simple as two clicks away from download. Maybe at one point there'll be a quick download link. I don't know yet. But the cool thing is that everything that we're doing on stream is going to appear here on this forum topic. So this forum topic is a recap of every episode that we did. For now, it's pretty simple. There's not much here, you know. But if you have any question, don't hesitate to log in and then reply there and ask anything you want, and I'll try to answer it at every stream. So for now, it's a little bit empty because I'm just starting that series. But here, you know, you can find the link to my Twitch channel. If you click there, you go right away to the devlog, so you can see every detail of what we did in the previous session. And there's also the last episode that you can check there with a beautiful cover and the YouTube link for those of you who are interested. Now, interestingly enough, is since we switched...
Hello, everyone.
Let me pause that. Since I switched to non-copyrighted song, I was able to put that video into Creative Commons Attribution License. That means that you can remix the video and use it for your own good. Now, there's also, if I'm not mistaken, an editor inside YouTube that lets you edit and extract things directly. So if you're interested in just cutting bits of the videos that I produce, don't hesitate to do it. Now, I'm aware that since I'm starting this, maybe there's not much interest there, but maybe at one point it will be interesting for people to do that. Okay, so let's go. Let's code some more Motionbox. So May 31, the backend torrent is, the basic parser is done. So if I run Motionbox here, now first of all, it starts on the wrong screen, which is normal. Let me put it there. There we go. So let me resize that a little bit. So yeah, what we did last time was pretty much demonstrating that the parsing was working. So let's do it again as a recap. If I go there, I have a download folder, and in my download folder, I have, let me do this and this. Okay, so I have two torrents there. They're 100% legal, obviously. So if I take one and drag it drop here, now what happens there is that Motionbox extracted the torrent and saw an AVI file inside of it. So he said, cool, you know what? That's a playlist because there's an AVI file inside of it. So now that this is done, I can do pretty much what I want with that track. That's the good thing about it. That means that I can drag and drop here and create a playlist, for instance. Call it torrent. And there we go. My torrent is going to appear there. So this is not a complete torrent. It's just a file inside of a torrent. That's the cool thing about it. If I go back here to my browsing experience, to my browser, I have another torrent there which appears. I fixed that. Previously it was broken. Now, when there is another torrent along with the one you're exploring, you can click on it too. And just like that, I've just extracted it. And here we go. So I can, once again, take this one, which is an MP4, drag and drop it, put it there, and there we go. So here, I successfully extracted two tracks in a matter of seconds from torrents. Imagine how powerful this is. Now, I can pretty much drag and drop and explore any torrent and extract tracks from it, extract video files from it. And the next step is obviously pretty straightforward. Now, one other thing which I'm doing in the background, and you'll be able to see that soon on the GitHub page, is I'm currently working on a solution to retrieve graphical covers for files like that. Because luckily enough, when you explore the web, and namely Bing, I'm using Bing currently, you can pretty much retrieve very compelling covers for a file like that. So I'm still coming up with the design that I wanted to adopt. Originally, what I wanted to do is retrieve the best picture possible. And if that's not possible, don't retrieve anything at all. But what I'm discovering by implementing it is that it's not as good as I hoped it would be. So once again, to demonstrate that, let me show you instead of talking about it. So if I go on Bing here, and if I type the name of this torrent, let's take the most obscure one, for instance. And let's see if it finds out anything. So I think that on Bing, I didn't find anything for this one. So what I'm doing already is I'm removing underscores, you know, and removing the extension there, and then just searching for it. And as you can see, Bing does a proper job in finding something that seems a little bit compelling, but that's not great. That's one of the problem I have currently is sometimes files and images appear and are related to the content, but they are not that great. So if I display that picture full screen, you know, the user is going to be distracted. He's going to feel, oh, this software is broken. He's displaying some kind of random cover. So instead of doing that, what I wanted to do currently is just having some small thumbnails appearing there, very discreet. And if MotionBox is confident about the fact that one of these is a good picture, it'll just display it full screen and the other as thumbnails. If he's not confident, it'll just display thumbnails. And if he's not confident at all, it won't display anything. There will be three steps for extracting covers. And I think that cracks it. That cracks the best implementation for random picture access, cover access with tracks like that. Now, keep in mind that I'm implementing Bing, but in the future, I could also implement other things like Last.fm covers or stuff like that. But anyway, let's proceed. So, yeah, like I said, now the next step for us is pretty much to play a torrent. That's what we need to do, and that's the reason why I compiled LibTorrent, because I want to stream torrents. So to do that, we need to hack a bunch of things. And I'm not using the term hack as a generic term here. I'm using it on purpose. So if we explore what the LibTorrent is all about, let's do that now. So LibTorrent is a feature complete C++ BitTorrent implementation, focusing on efficiency and scalability. That's exactly what I'm all about, so I'm very happy about that. It runs on embedded devices as well as desktop. Ooh. It boasts a well-documented user interface that is easy to use. Now, here's something real quick that I would like to explain. That I would like to express, at least, because I'm not trying to be a teacher here. So, let me pause that for a second, or let me lower it down a little bit. You know what? Let's start to pause it for a while. So, let me explain that a little bit. People, when they see libraries like that, and when they see a library like LibTorrent, and I'm not sure what this is about here, but when they see a library like LibTorrent, most people are going to think right away, including engineers, they're going to think, okay, this torrent, this library is designed to create application in any form that downloads torrents on your hard drive. People think that right away. And most of the people, when they actually, I think that's what I believe, when they're actually going to school, people are going to teach them that, you know, this is going to do that. This design is best for this. you should do it this way. Use that design patterns, you know, way to develop, conventional way to develop. Do it like that. Avoid doing like that. Well, they just learn best practices, if you will. Now, in a hacker mind, things go a little bit differently. A hacker does not see things for the way they are designed. You know, when I'm looking at LibTorrent, I'm not going to it with a preconceived idea of what I should do with it. That's an important distinction here. I don't care about what I should do about it. What I care is what I'm trying to achieve myself, what I'm all about myself, what I want to design. And what I want to design with Motionbox is a video browser, a video player for the next decade, if you will, for the post-internet era. That's what I care in this project. And so in order to do that, I believe that one of the things which is key is peer-to-peer videos, because obviously it's a very powerful technology, not to mention that it's good for sharing. That's the reason why I care about LibTorrent. So I'm going to LibTorrent not to embrace the philosophy and the vision you should have when using that library, the preconceived idea you should have, you might get. I'm coming to LibTorrent and envision it as a tool, as a way to achieve what I want to do. And so I'm not going to use it the way it's intended to be used. I'm going to hack it as much as possible to make video streaming as compelling as possible. Now, I also want to be to make sure that the job I'll be doing with it is a good job, that it's efficient, that it's working well and everything. But one of the things which I found out is that there are a lot of things that you can do when you don't restrict yourself in thinking in a specific way. There are lots of things that you can achieve if you have a vision and if you just iterate on it and don't see technology as it was designed for, but technology for what it can do. That's what really matters at the end. And that's what a hacker is all about to me. A hacker hasn't got preconceived idea about technology, uses technology pushing the innovation forward in order to achieve a meaningful goal. That's what hacking is all about if you go away from all the ethical consideration. Now, from my definition, hacking is also, working towards a goal, an ethical goal. But if you put ethics aside, a hacker is all about that, you know, using meaningful technology the way he wants to achieve what he wants to achieve by pushing the innovation as far as possible. That's what it is in my mind, and that's what I love about it. That's what I want to do actually with LibTorrent. So if we go real quick into the player I'm currently using, as you can see, we see a bunch of functions. So this player is pretty classic, even though it works great with a playlist and a bunch of settings. It's a pretty efficient player. Now, a player like that, if I'm not mistaken, I believe that's is using a backend to play video. So what a backend is, it's just like, you know, what we're using. Let's put some music back here. Just like what I'm using for extracting content on the internet, I'm also having a backend approach for player. And the reason for that is because I want an abstraction, one, just one, so that I can switch from one player to the other. Now, I really love VLC and the way it works. Now, there's two layers. Let me show you that actually. So if we go to backend VLC, there's an abstract backend that's defined here. So the abstract backend is a specific class, base class. There's not much, by the way, in my project, I'm not using inheritance a lot. I just have a few bases classes and then one or two child levels. And the reason for that is because I like my architecture, my design to be as flat as possible. That's more efficient, and you know, you don't really need to do tons and tons of inheritance. So I don't do polymorphism, for instance. I mean, beside doing, sorry about that, beside doing privatable here, I'm not doing polymorphism in most of the cases. I like to focus on a single design. And so I'll be right back, actually.
I'm gonna lie, I never used Unity. Everything you just did sounded gibberish. Well, funny thing is, this isn't Unity.
Okay, sorry about that, I'm back. And sorry for the stream in the back that you might have heard. I was just checking if my stream was appearing on Twitch. Sometimes I get a little bit skeptical about that. Let me just get back to my page and you know, to see if there's anyone who asking question, who asked question in the chat actually. And let me just So what I'm doing is I'm editing the HTML3 view to just delete the player. Oh, actually, I delete the whole page here. Hold on a sec. So, yeah, hold on. No, mute. Well, I'll just pose it like that. That should do it. Okay, so back to us with my cool... with my cool... Idle cover there. So, okay. So, like I was saying, I'm not sure where I was at. Let's pause the sound because I'm explaining stuff here. It's easier for me to focus. So, Like I was saying, I'm not using polymorphism much and I'm not using inheritance much. I'm coding with the C++, with the Qt standard because they make it clearer. And I'm coding pretty much like a C program. Lots of iterative stuff, global controllers all the way that I can call at any point. And that's what does it for me. Now, the object philosophy, I wouldn't be as extreme as rejecting it. I think the object philosophy design is a good one because it forces you to organize your code. Now, it forces you to organize your code into some specific ways that you could do maybe better. And by the way, you can also use classes in C by hacking a few stuff, I believe. And so I think classes are fine. But I think the problem with C++ and the reason why you really need to restrict yourself a lot when using it is that it offers you a lot of dangerous tools, pretty much, of dangerous standards and possibilities and templating and stuff like that, which are going to create more potential issue for you. And so at the beginning, you know, it was like when I learned C++, people were like, oh, well, we're going to learn templates. It's going to be so powerful and so useful. And I'm not even sure I'm actually using templates in my code here, you know, because the sexiness of C++ in lots of ways is not a good way to go. You know, the best way to go is to keep things simple. And when you need to optimize, do it at the very end and do it on very important part. And even when you're optimizing, templating is often not a good idea. So that's one of the funny things is I went to a lot of interviews actually recently because I'm looking to find a paid job. And one of the funny thing which I noticed, which I like, is lots of people were trying to evaluate my skills in C++ by asking me a few questions about the standard library, about advanced, you know, stuff, because they thought, oh, this guy has been coding for 10 years. He must be very aware of that. And I'm not at all. In fact, I'm trying to forget lots of these because I don't want to keep them in my mind so they would distract me. I don't want to keep templates in my mind all the time. I don't want to keep a bunch of best practice of C++, supposed best practice that I know are not good because I learned the painful way that it just does not work, both technical-wise, but more importantly, design-wise. And so that's the reason why, you know, what makes me a good programmer, or at least an experienced programmer from my perspective, is not my ability to understand advanced feature of the C++. Instead, what makes me a good programmer is not using these and focusing on doing a great design that does the job, that scales very well, that is very readable, and that works as intended. And in lots of ways, that implies not using polymorphism much beyond privatable stuff here, and not using much of inheritance, because if you do that a lot, it gets confusing and it gets very slow. And so, you know, that's one of the important things that I learned about that. So instead of talking too much, let's resume this. So my player is accepting a backend here. And here you can see the abstract backend there, which is defined. And I've obviously, well, you know what? Let's see actually who inherits that. Yeah, just the backend VLC. So the backend VLC is an implementation of that standard to be able to play video through VLC. Very simple, right? And so as you can see, there's a bunch of implementation and re-implementation. So implementation are mandatory. If you don't implement these, it's not going to work at all. So set source, play, replay, pause, stop, volume, and so on, stuff like that. So if I run MotionBox real quick here, you'll see, let me do a demonstration for you. If I'm typing, I don't know, Warcraft here, for instance. And if I go there, what happens there is that the player is ready to start. So let me put the sound here. Let me put some music back. And so I can, and so when I hit play, I don't know if you noticed, but in the back, something happened. So we loaded the source and we've extracted from the YouTube page the proper video file right there. So the video file is there, and so what happens next is VLC pretty much received the set source here. And so when the set source arrives, VLC says, cool, a new source to be played, let's do that. So we reset the current state. If I'm currently playing, I'm just going to, you know, update buffering, stopping and then loading the source. And when I'm loading the source, I'm just going to connect to the proper slot, make sure that the source is loaded or not. Maybe it's loaded already. So in that case, I'm just applying it there. And as you can see here, there's a bunch of things which happens. I'm just setting the current media and the current audio. That's one of the cool stuff about MotionBox. You can specify it in the player. What is the video and what is the audio? And so that's useful because in lots of backend, well, in YouTube mostly, there's a video file and an audio file, and I can play these two. And so here you can see the current source that we're on is here. And so right there. And so when it calls play media, and play media is in backend VLC private. It's pretty much calling the set source on the player. Now, what is the player? Well, it's the VLC core player that you see there. So the VLC core player is just an encapsulated object. As you can see, very simple, just an object. And this is just the raw player that I'm embedding inside of the backend VLC. The great thing about that is I could be rewriting another backend that uses the VLC player, but with a twist, actually, if I want. So here, you see, if I do F4 here, now we are on the VLC side of things. So there's a bunch of VLC call here, like the get size here. But more importantly, if I go all the way there, the bunch of event that I'm monitoring on the VLC side. The VLC library is very good, actually. It's quite performant, quite efficient, which is what really matters. And it works well and does the job, and it's written in C, which I love because it's very simple to use and to call. For a low level like that, for a low level library like that, it's very cool. And so what happens is that when I'm seeking stuff like that, I'm pretty much sending signals to the VLC player, says, hey, I just went to that position, could you please update the current video status? And so that's what happened, you know, every time I do that. And then I change the source, and VLC is just streaming the content. I'm providing the source, the raw source to VLC. It's a raw MP4. And then I say, you know, you're really good at playing sources like that. Go ahead and play it. And so that's what happens. And so, you know, if we get back here, you can see here's the most important function, most likely the source setting. So there's a bunch of options there, including proxy, if you've specified one, because MotionBox supports it actually there. I found that to be useful at one point when YouTube was not working very well on the free, you know, internet service that we're using in France. I was using free proxy, and YouTube, believe it or not, was working way better through the free proxy. So using another route than the free ISP server made it work well, including like very big ADP video, 1080p video, which was really amazing. But now they fixed it a little bit, and so YouTube works better, but it still isn't perfect. And one of the things which I'm going to need, which people are requesting now, is to be able to preload the video or download it, so that even if the video streaming is slow, you can just preload one video, watching another one that's in cache, you know, and then switching to the other one. That's one of the thing, one of the top priority list, along with multi-platform implementation and stuff like that. You know, so we'll see later about that. You know. So, where was I at? Okay, I wasn't there. So let's just reset this. As you can see, I can reset the state of the browser real quick. Let's go there. Let's get that. Let's quit that. And let's go back where I was at. I was on, backend VLC. I was explaining that. And media. Okay. So, what we need to do now is start from this and find a way to add torrent support for that. So in order to do that, we first need to understand the way I'm going to use LibTorrent to stream video files, because like I said, it's not a classical way of doing it. It's kind of a hack. So to do that, let me load right away a website that I found. Let me search for that actually. Right there. Okay, let's do that together. Want links right there. Okay, so. So this guy, and that's one of the things on the internet, you have lots of great stuff that don't get much attention, but are very interesting. You know, lots of people, and the way the internet works these days is this way. If you're not spamming the communication pipes, you know, like Twitter, Facebook, and stuff like that, and you're not uploading content all the time, and you don't have people dedicated to communicate for you and to do a bunch of marketing stuff, so they say, you don't get much traction. But when you know how to use a browser and how to use, you know, Google very simply, you can find some great stuff. And this guy really did something great here, which is, explains it himself. He tested a couple of available applications available. So, you know, he's trying to do BitTorrent live streaming, obviously. He mentions it. So he read academic paper. There's a bunch of them there, proposing improvement to the BitTorrent protocol. So once again, he highlights what I said previously, which was, you know, it's a hack currently of the LibTorrent to stream by right away. And so, you know, proposing Provena to help with the focusing mainly on modification to piece-to-piece selection mechanism in client. Yeah. So it tested a couple of available application with the standard BT protocol, but use sequential download. That's the key here. You see, there's an option in quite a few BitTorrent software these days to sequentially download things. And that's really important because you want to be able to start getting the pieces at the beginning in order to achieve proper streaming. That's quite obvious. Now, there's a little bit of a twist here, which is, let me take a little bit of water. The twist is when you're seeking in the video, namely when you're doing this, you need to sequentially play it, but at another point. So you need to be able to support seeking. So you need to be aware that when the user is seeking, so now I don't care about the pieces there. I care about the pieces there. So I need to sequentially download them from now on, from this position, in order to achieve proper streaming. Pretty simple. So, uses sequential download and piece prioritization to stream video file. Yeah. So, he tried this one, and I also tried it, which is Ace Stream. I think that's kind of a Russian site. It's very, it looks cool, I mean, but it's proprietary, it's closed. So, we're not going to dig much into this one. But I've tried it and it actually works well, but it works with a very special implementation. namely a server client with stuff that it's like there's a server, a torrent server running on the background, and the player VLC is just a tweaked VLC to access that server. It's not very straightforward at all. But, you know, it works well. Honestly, it works well. This one, Pulsar, and I'm also not sure what this one is doing. Could do some evil stuff. Who knows? Pulsar right there. So, I haven't tried this one, actually. That's the extension of... that's an extension, sorry about that, of the XBMC torrent. So, yeah. I haven't tried this one. PureFlix, I've tried this one. Streaming BitTorrent client, written in JavaScript, running on the node. Used in popular Popcorn Time application. PureFlix seemed to be fastest to start play, provided also best 6 responses, and that's what I found out too. So, let me talk about PureFlix for a second. Actually, let's go to their site here. So, you know, before Popcorn Time got traction, that thing existed prior to Popcorn Time. PureFlix is the heart of Popcorn Time. That's what made it possible. When Popcorn Time got introduced in the beginning, it got traction really fast because the PureFlix technology worked really well. That's what I believe, at the very least, at least. So, to explain why Popcorn Time was successful, I have my own theory, so I'm going to explain it to you. The reason why Popcorn Time got so much traction is not because of Popcorn Time. The reason Popcorn Time got so much traction is because of two things, two factors. The first factor is the fact that Popcorn Time is, if you want, a free sharing equivalent to Netflix. So Popcorn Time got exposition in the press and other stuff, and other media on the internet and elsewhere, because it was a free Netflix, if you will. So Popcorn Time is a mirror, got publicity, if you want, or communication, out of the way that it was a mirror, a free mirror, if you want, of the paid Netflix software, which at the same time was using loads and loads of budgets, you know, to push its marketing and to implement everywhere on the globe, including France and in a bunch of countries. So, let me explain that real quick. For me, the reason why Popcorn Time got successful is because of that. It's because it's the mirror, if you want, it's the dark side or the light side of the Netflix model. Popcorn Time got famous because of Netflix. Because it's a free Netflix and because it proposes the same experiment as Netflix, except it's freaking torrents, so it's free. That's the reason why it got traction. But there's another one. Another reason why it got traction is because it uses PureFlix and PureFlix works well. PureFlix, for the first time, was able to, you know, just with a simple command like that, pretty much stream torrents. So it was based on the YiFi release system. I'm not very familiar about the torrent scene. Let's not talk much about that because, you know, we don't want to go into these waters on the stream. But, you know, it pretty much worked because it was a mirror of, it was a free mirror of Netflix, reason one. Reason two, great technology, PureFlix technology. And reason three, last but not least, but at least not the best, not the main reason, because it was really easy to use, just like Netflix is, and it had a funny mascot, you know, the popcorn guy here. And so it made it, how could I put that? It disables the fear that one could have using a file to access torrent file, because lots of people are really scared about this technology. And so when you put a funny popcorn guy, people get cool about it and they say, oh, you know, it's a funny popcorn guy, what wrong could it do? And so let's just use it. That's the three reasons why Popcorn Time succeeded, because it's a mirror, free mirror of Netflix, because technology works great. It was at the intersection of working technologies. And the third reason is because it had a funny mascot which disables the scariness that one could get when running a Popcorn Time, when running a torrent streaming application. And actually, with Motionbox, I'm less lucky about these. Now, first of all, because I'm not mirroring anything, I'm innovating. So there's no equivalent to Motionbox, which could be seen as a bad thing, but I see that as a really good thing. You know, the very fact of building this, which is a unique proposal and is not mirroring anything existing in the paid, in the proprietary, not necessarily paid, but in the private proprietary software, to me is a great asset. But at the same time, it means that I'm not going to benefit from marketing that someone else did, you know, and then coming up and saying, you know, I do the same than this guy who did lots of marketing, except I'm free. I cannot do that. So I'm not getting much traction actually with Motionbox on that side. I don't want to use the PeerFlix technology. And the reason for that is because I want to use low level C to be as efficient as possible. So I cannot use that technology as is. So it makes it also a technological challenge, if you will. And last but not least, now the funny mascot and stuff like that, that's something I would like to do. I would like to have a mascot for Motionbox. Not because it's a funny cool stuff, and not because I want to do marketing. I don't do any marketing with Motionbox. I do communication. The more passive and the more organic it is, the better. I try to be 100% real about what I do. Now, this small guy here, which is my avatar, I would like mostly maybe to use it as a mascot for Motionbox. I'm not sure how it would fit, but maybe a little guy would give you advice or tips or anything like that. Because Motionbox looks so serious currently that I think it wouldn't hurt for it to be more, you know, of a funny and light-hearted, if you want, a little more light-hearted, a little more reassuring, because technology and innovation by itself can be scary to people. You know, people don't really understand what it is, and you know, explaining what Motionbox is all about is sometimes a little bit hard. And so, you know, explaining to people what Motionbox is all about, you know, can be pretty hard. So let me just close these, first of all. And let me take a small break, and when I'm back, we'll try to do design. I'll show you how I design, the way I design. So, yeah. Okay, I'm back. Thank you very much for being here. And we're taking a look at what we're currently doing, which is reflecting and thinking, brainstorming, if you want, about what we're going to do to stream Torrent. So going back to my guy here, what he says is here, all these guys, all these clients, let me zoom that a little bit. all these clients are working in a similar fashion. There is separate BT client process that uses sequential mode to download torrent. So the funny thing here, it's a hack to stream torrent with torrent libraries, but people are using the same method, which is sequential download. Now, pieces are downloaded and it streams them via HTTP protocol to the video player. Playback starts when enough data is cached. In XBMC, it was 1% of torrent size. So, quite a few things to be said there. One, there's no way, you cannot know how long is the video file you're trying to access. If you're downloading a file, if you're getting a file of 1 gigabyte, you don't know if it's going to be a poorly encoded file and if it's going like to be 30 minutes of poorly encoded video or maybe 10 hours of really encoded, really hardly encoded video. So you have no way of knowing whether the playback is going to be smooth or not. And that's one of the things that Popcorn Time mitigated, because he knew that if we focus on sources that were well peered, that people had a lot on their hard drive, in most cases, now, first of all, he had an API, so he knew how long was the video. So if you know how long is the video before accessing it, you can rely on something else than the percentage of what you get, of the torrent you're getting. Motionbox is going to work differently. Motionbox is going to be very different about that. Motionbox does not care about implementing a given API or anything like that. Motionbox cares about extracting torrent and playing file inside of it, no matter what they are. And here's the catch. In lots of ways, in quite a lot of occasion, it might struggle to do so. You might start a file and it's too big, or your bandwidth is not enough. And so in that case, what I want to do, and what Motionbox is probably going to do, is going to tell, okay, I'm trying to play that file and it seems that VLC is struggling having a fluid playback there. You know what? We can download it in the background, and when it's done, I'll just tell you. And when it's done, I'll just tell you, and you'll just play it. And so why don't you play something else while this downloads? And so it's not an issue for Motionbox, because it's going to try to stream, and if it does not succeed, no big deal. It will just tell you, you know what? I've tried to stream that, doesn't work, download it, and we'll stream it once it's download. No problem. So obviously you see that one of the next steps for me is going to be to handle downloading. That's one of the things which I will have to do for that. And that's not of the... it won't be for the next release, maybe the next one. Maybe after the Linux version, I don't know. But that's one important thing to be said. I'm sorry, I'm talking a lot in that stream, but you know, I'm also using that stream as an history for what I did previously. And so if I want to go back in 6 months from there, what was my thought process? It's very interesting to have it on the video. So, playback start when enough data is cached. Yeah, that's not what I want to highlight here. Torrent and pieces are downloaded. It streams them via HTTP. It streams them via HTTP. So what happens is, when you're running PeerFlix, let's go back to PeerFlix once again. You're running that command with a magnet or a torrent, and PeerFlix is going to get the file, and he's going to create an HTTP server. He's going to create a freaking server, man, so that VLC can connect to it. So it's local server, and so it can stream video through an emulated, if you want, HTTP server. So that VLC really thinks that he is accessing a URL, a streaming URL of some sort, and he just does streaming on it. Now, it's a cool abstraction because, yeah, I'm just creating local HTTP server and stream the file. And like many people, like most of you might know, VLC is not just a player. First of all, it's a streamer. It streams lots of sources, actually. It can stream lots of stuff. And the difference between the player and the streamer is that the player just opens a flight, plays it, and once it's done, VLC is capable of connecting to a source, lots of source, and quite a few protocols indeed, and streams them. Now, there's something obvious here that you might see or that you might feel is, why the heck would I need to create a freaking HTTP server when the file is downloaded locally on my drive? Why would I need to do that? I mean, it's pointless. Why would you need to create a whole HTTP server and accessing through the HTTP protocol standard, if you will, when the file is just locally on your drive? Well, I'll tell you why. because PeerFlix is a standalone software that just gets the file and then streams it to a player. It's just a piece. Just like most implementations are doing. Actually, I believe Astream is doing the same. Astream is originally some kind of torrent retrieving stuff that connects to VLC. So these guys, they're just doing torrent a streamer, if you want. Let's shut the sound. Actually, you know what? Let's keep the sound. So what these guys are doing, they're just doing a server-based client that then is going to stream to the player. That's what they're doing. So instead of doing that, I'm going to do it differently for MotionBox. Instead of having an HTTP server, I'm going to do it right away. And the reason I can do that is because since I'm having my own VLC player running in MotionBox, like I said, it's just there. You know, I'm having my own VLC that's right there, that's running in MotionBox. I know what VLC is doing at any time. So say, for instance, I'm loading the file and then playing the file and then seeking to a point in the video. Well, what would happen with PeerFlix? So I would assume, I haven't checked in depth what it does, but what happens is that it's going to go in PeerFlix, say, you know what, I don't want those pieces anymore. I want this one and this one. And when the download is good enough, it's going to say, hey, I have enough data. So now I'm going to push that data through the server and notify VLC that, hey, there's more data for you or anything like that. So I believe that's what it's going to do. It's going to tell to VLC, you know what, it's good enough. I'm not very familiar with it. Actually, maybe I'll dig deeper into the way it works, but pretty much that's what happens. Once I have enough data, let just VLC seek, or at least VLC seeking, let me wait for me to have enough data, and then I just stream to it. So yeah. Okay, sorry about that. I'm just I'm trying to focus a little bit on what I'm doing here. That's the issue there. The situation there, it's going to seek to the file, it's going to download the pieces, and then once he has them, it's going to say to tell VLC, okay, add them, go for it. And so there's an overhead of network access, back and forth network access, that is not needed at all. Now, since it's done locally, you might expect that it's doing it efficiently. But, you know, still, that's an overhead. We're not going to do it this way. We're going to do it directly. We're going to download the file directly and play it directly. And when VLC is struggling to play the file, well, no big deal. We're just going to wait for the file to be more loaded and try again every few milliseconds. Indeed, when I get more data, I'll just tell to VLC, try to play it again at this point. Maybe there's more data for you. And so, since I don't need to be notified by HTTP, okay, the file is loaded. Now you can play it. I can just do it on the VLC side directly and tell VLC, until VLC through an abstraction, you know, maybe we're not ready to seek there. Try to seek there, and if it fails, you know, go back to this location, or, you know, just display a loading screen or something like that. And once it's complete, just start streaming. So by doing that, I'm completely avoiding it, the streaming, the HTTP streaming there. I can just focus on doing a great player and focus on doing the best experience I can, actually. So let's proceed. Okay, so what he decided to do is to create a simple streaming BT client in Python. Python is pretty good, actually. It uses excellent libtorrent library. So he praises libtorrent library, which is... Which is the one we're using, which enables to do sequential download and advanced piece prioritization. BT client is a command line utility. So yeah, now he's explaining what it does. And so the cool thing there is that it puts implementation notes. And by the way, let me add this guy's pages on the links category here. So yeah. So there's that, and there's another one which I wanted to add. Okay, that's actually the code for what it did. So yeah. Hold on. Yeah. This guy is a little bit of a complicated name, but yeah. Maybe I'll try to contact him, actually, to notify him that I'm doing this. Maybe he could be of great help. So yeah, BT client. GitHub BT client. There we go. So next time you can check in the devlog, you'll be able to retrieve that. Let me categorize them this way. So yeah, C++ bin code. Actually, yeah, that's bin code here. So bin code and torrents there. Okay, good enough. So let's go back. So I would like to apologize because this video is going to be a little bit talkative and not much coding is going to be take place there. But I think that's interesting to have a glimpse of the way I'm brainstorming, even if it's not perfect at first. And the way I'm designing in my head before implementing it real fast and then iterating loads of time until I have something good enough but not perfect, and that's important. The way that I design is I go as fast as possible into practical code, into practical implementation. But I stop iterating when the code is really good, not when it's perfect, because if it's perfect, I cannot change it anymore. If it's perfect, there's optimization everywhere, and then the code becomes to be uneditable and you cannot change it because it's just too specific. And so the important thing here is to do things well, but not perfect, so that you can iterate and make it evolve. Because what's great about software is the way that it evolves, it's the way that you can change it And what's great also about the free software model is that people can come and contribute to what you're doing. And if the code is not perfect, they can understand it. And if they can understand it, they can contribute. So, makes sense. Anyway, so yeah. What I need to figure out, and maybe I won't figure it out on stream, because for that I often need walks, long walks, and thinking how I could do it and then implementing it right away. But it doesn't take much time. It takes like an hour of brainstorming or so. Everything happens in my head, and then I go back and I say, I know how to implement it. I try an implementation that doesn't work, that doesn't cut it. I take everything I learned from it and move to another one. And when I'm at one or two, or the first to the second design, at one point it gets good. And so at this point, I know that I can start iterating. And even though after iterating 10 times, I realize it's not the good one, still I can take everything that I learned, everything that I could, and move it to another design. That's the way I'm designing. I'm designing by iterating and by not being scared of trying another design. The thing to mention here, which is very important, is that you never know until you've applied it, until you've coded it. You never know if it's going to work well or not. You know for experience only. Only your experience can tell you if something is likely to work or not. But even with experience, you never know. That's one of the key things here to understand. You cannot learn how to code by learning theory. You need to get out of here and you need to try stuff. And lots of stuff are not going to be intuitive. Lots of stuff are going to be counterintuitive. And you're not going to be able to figure that out theoretically. On theory, you're going to need to implement it and to just do it. So yeah, enough of talking endlessly here. Let's focus for a sec. So okay, so what I need to do here is pretty simple. Obviously, I need to play things. So the play function here is going to call back and play. And in VLC is going to call play. Now, there's a hook there. I need to call, when I'm calling play, I need to call something else, which is my libtorrent. I need to tell him, start buffering, start loading. And what I really need to do actually is start buffering here. And once buffering is ready, then I need to call play. So that's a thing that you might see here. I need a system so that the user can call a play here, which is not really not the real play itself, but at least the libtorrent buffering before I call the actual backend play on VLC. So how can we do that? What's the best way to do it? So there's a bunch of ways we could do it. Now we could implement it inside of the abstract backend by itself. So we could, hold on a sec. So one of the things we could do, and this is very real here because I haven't thought about that before. So I'm really discovering this with you. Here, I'm implementing the backend, okay? So we could imagine doing backend torrent here, for instance, or backend torrent VLC, something like that. So I could inherit VLC there. And when the backend play is called there, for instance, what I could do is, call libtorrent and say, hey, could you please load that file? And once this is ready, then I can call the actual backend VLC, which I inherit there, the actual backend VLC play. Thing that I don't like about this model is, what if I want to use another player? What if I want to use, I don't know, another player to play the video? Well, my solution does not scale because here I'm just going to do that. There's going to be torrent VLC, and so I'm just going to, you know, implement a new backend play and then maybe doing like this. well, actually surely doing that like that. If I do that, the issue there is VLC. I'm tied to VLC. I don't want to be tied to VLC. Even though I might stick with VLC for the whole development process of MotionBox, design-wise, it does not make sense to be tied to it. So I cannot do that. We have an issue there. I cannot do that, so I don't want to do that. Now, one could say, you know, do an abstract backend torrent, okay? And make VLC inherit of this one instead of this one. So is it a good idea? Let's find out, you know, let's brainstorm about that. So look, if I do that, of course I'm going to, by default, inherit of all that. And I'm going to have the play function here. And so what I can do is, but then again, here is going to call back and play right away. And here in that case, it's going to be VLC. And so I could do something like play is a virtual function. And I could make this virtual here. Virtual means that you can redefine it, actually. So I could do something like that, you know. And so I could, for instance, in my abstract backend torrent, if you want, I can re-implement play. I could do that. But if I do that, once again, I need to do a bunch of stuff with the state here, the sources valid and stuff like that. Play it and then setting the state. So there's a bunch of calls that I'm going to need to re-implement in order to do that. So if someone wants to do something close to BitTorrent support for something else later and he wants to implement something new, he will also have to understand how abstract backend works. So that's not great, because maybe he wants to and he should, because you write better code when you understand the technology underneath it. But by default, if I'm doing a simple implementation, I don't want people to, you know, re-implement play and replay and pause and stop. So so we have an issue there. So how can I do that? How can I do that? By the way, if you have any idea, any design ideas you want to share, once again, I'd like to point out that if you type omega-motionbox/chapter1, you'll get to this page and you can comment there. Don't hesitate to put a comment. No question is silly, no question is wrong. With every question, even if the question fails at delivering something important, it's always a step forward. And so don't hesitate, and you can just type that. Just type omega.gg and just go for it. Go there and there, and there you go. So yeah, so we've already seen two things that we could do. So let me recap here what we did. So we first thought of about doing a backend VLC, backend torrent VLC, if you will. But the problem is it's too tied. It's tied, man, with VLC. We don't want that. Then we thought about doing an abstract backend VLC, but it requires base code to be rewritten. So that's an issue there. So we're not going to do that, and we're not going to do that either. So what now? What now? What can we do? What's the best way of doing that? Well, I don't know yet. We have to think about that. Here. I know that I need some kind of process, which is like load torrent or something like that. And then I most likely need to do some kind of connection there. We have some kind of connection. Like, something like that, you know. Like, say, I don't know, connect an object torrent that would be private. Maybe do something like that, you know. So I pretty much to do that, and I need to most likely do this after the if there, you know. I'm just writing code that's not going to compile, obviously. I'm just doing it for the sake of it. Now, yeah. So once this is done, so I probably need to do that. Like if it's something like you know if it's a freaking torrent, then load it and then connect. Maybe we're just already connected. Else we're going there. Something like that, you know. So just like that, I've imagined the way it could work. So that's cool, but what if I don't want to support torrent in my application? Torrent is a very specific stuff that we want to do with MotionBox, but it's specific. So it's going to be an overhead of just implementing it right away to AppStack backend. It's going to be messy. I don't want that. So let's go back. Yeah. So, what do we need to do? Yeah, even pose is most likely going to have to call the backend every time. Yeah, backend play is called there. So, yeah, if I call backend play. Yep. Okay. Afraid there's no perfect way of doing so, of doing it. Because here I could re-implement backend play, but that doesn't work because I want to call it later instead of calling it at all. So I could also do, I could do it another way. Let me explain it to you. Oh, hold on. Maybe I won't find out on that stream, and that's completely okay, because obviously it can get hard to think while streaming. So if I don't understand it today, most likely when we are back on Thursday, I'll have it figured out. But one of the things we can do here is, in the VLC player, in the declarative player. Yeah, we could do it there. So what we could do there is, we could do that. Like something like VLC backend. And that encapsulates backend VLC. So that way, that I encapsulate a backend. So that way we just have to code. But if we do that, it requires, yeah. Once again, we also have that issue in a very even worse way. Because if I do a custom backend there, if I do a different kind of backend, if I rewrite, so it requires redundant code to be written. So it's not going to be the same. Okay? So I'm not going to have to rewrite the same code as in there. I can rewrite just the code that I need. But most likely it's going to be redundant. So we don't want to do that either. VLC backend wouldn't be good. You know. Torrent backend. Wouldn't that be good? No, that wouldn't be great. So, you know, we don't want to do that. So what do we want to do? How can we implement that? Especially since we got checking here. Backend play, set state. Yeah, especially since I'm setting state right away. So if backend plays later, I will never set the state, which is not good. We need to. Yeah. And we also need to call that anyway. Okay. So no, doesn't work. Okay. I think I know how I'm going to do it. I think I've cracked it. Hold on. I have an idea. Let me explain it to you what we could do. So here's the way we could implement that. I could do a new backend, all right? I could do like, whoops. It's an exciting and scary stream actually, because I'm thinking out loud, so I could come up with some very, very weird stuff, and it makes me feel a little bit uncomfortable, but at the same time, it's an interesting experience of just being real. So, look, I could do that. I could do... I could do backend torrent, okay? So we've demonstrated that it's wrong to do backend torrent VLC. So let's do backend torrent itself, okay? Now, let's encapsulate backend VLC inside of it, all right? So what will happen? Let's do a backend that encapsulates another backend. So, once again, this is the reason why coding is so counterintuitive. Because you might think that encapsulation is bad, and if we're encapsulating tons of code, it's going to get really slow. But I think it's a very elegant solution, actually. Let me explain to you why. The reason why it's good is because all I have to do, well, what I have to do is I can just re-implement these function, okay, from my backend torrent right away. And so when I get there and I know, hold on, actually, hold on a sec. Yeah. Okay, so here, yeah. It's not a problem, actually. Okay. Yeah, okay, so I can keep the same structure, the same abstract structure. That structure is valid. That works for me. Yeah, the source has changed and anything. What I need to do is I need to ensure that backend torrent is a man in the middle, so that backend torrent can say, hey, hold on a sec. Yeah, I think backend torrent is going to need a backend at creation, another backend, which is the player, because it needs to keep it for the whole life cycle. So it needs to be mandatory. Yeah, anything. Anyway, let's not focus too much on the specifics here, but what I'll have to do is implementing, like for instance, in set source, what I have to do is just, when you're setting the source, maybe I'll do something like loading the torrent. And then just loading the torrent. In play, what I have to do is ensure enough data is downloaded, you know. If so, call I call backend VLC backend play. So I know it's a bit of a, you know. So in my backend torrent there, if so called backend, whoops, something like that, you know. So in that way, I'm going to keep the very same, how would you say it? I'm going to keep the very same model, the very same abstraction backend design, if you want. I'm just going to introduce some code in between the torrent loading and the VLC playback, and it's going to be flawless. It's just a function call. I'm calling my backend play on my torrent, backend torrent. And once it's done, it's going to call the other backend play. And so they're going to be stacked. And it's going to be extremely efficient because there's no overhead there. The backend torrent does its thing. And once it did it, you know, just call the player, call the encapsulated player. So there's no overhead there, even though design-wise it might think counterintuitive. So that's one of the reasons why you gotta think beyond conventions. So encapsulation is obviously a very common design, but you know, the idea of having a man in the middle is also a design. But you know, I don't really think in terms of design. That's the funny thing, in fact. I just proven to you the way I work. The way I work is thinking about concrete solution for a very specific problem and coming up with a solution that might work. This might not be the final implementation that I do. There's a good chance that it could be, but it might not be that. My thought process is really focusing on solving the problem. And once I solve the problem, you know, somebody might come to my office and say, or to my room, because I'm currently in my living room, and say, all right, I know this is a pattern. Lots of people are doing that. When they're seeing something that they don't really understand or that they cannot really separate into different pieces that they might understand, they take the whole thing and put it inside a box because it's reassuring of saying, yeah, I just did that, I understand that. People hate when they don't understand things. Even worse, they're afraid of not understanding stuff. So here my thought process was not at all about design pattern, but some guy might come and say, this is that design pattern. So this guy, you know, has read this book and this book and this book and this book. I haven't. I don't give a shit about reading books. What I give a damn about is implementing the name stuff and so that it can work. And if somebody comes afterward and say, this is that pattern and whatever, and so what? So what? It doesn't matter. What matters is that the code works. And so I work the other way around. I go from practical code all the way to theory. At the end, once the practical code is done, you might be able to theorize a bunch of stuff about it. But the way I work is really practical thinking all the way to theoretical stuff. And then we can discuss with theory, with theoretical terms. But, you know, that's not the way the solution was found. Template will never, pattern or anything like that. No books will ever find a solution for you. You'll find it by practicing and by getting better at understanding that coding is counterintuitive, and so that you have to, the more you practice, the better you get. You have, coding is all about doing it. It's all about practicing concretely. And the more you do that, the more, the better you get. So yeah. I hope I don't sound too pedantic about all that, but I really believe in that. I really mean it. So, you know, just my opinion anyway. It's just my opinion. And quick disclaimer, everything that I say here goes right from my mind to my mouth. So maybe I might say some, you know, wrong things. And if that's the case, don't get offended in any way. I'm just thinking out loud and being as honest as possible. And maybe actually I need to pay attention at what I'm saying here. So okay. So this... seems to be the good one. A backend torrent that can encapsulate a player backend. So we're going to make, and that's one of the, that's also a hack, you know. Once again, I'm not seeing backend as what it's meant to do. It's meant to be implementing a player. It's meant to be implemented by a player. Here, I'm not going to implement it by a player. Here, I'm going to implement it a backend torrent, which is not a player at all. But I don't care about that, because I'm going to trigger declarative player into thinking that it's calling a player, when in fact it's calling an abstraction, it's calling a function, a class that encapsulates another player and that does lots of stuff torrent wise before really loading the stuff, before really playing the good stuff. And that's completely okay, because for the declarative player it's going to be transparent. And it's going to be a very good implementation so that we can tweak the torrenting without hurting the backend VLC, so that the backend VLC can do its thing while the backend torrent can do his. And if there is an issue in one of these, I can just fix them. So instead of babbling, I love that term, babbling. Instead of babbling for a long time here, what I'm going to do right now is I'm going to create that backend. So let's do it. If I go there and I show that in Explorer, you can see that in media I have a bunch of backend. This is actually pretty wrong. Hold on. It's media too. So we're going to have an issue. Anyway, we're going to have an issue. So now I have an issue with my... I have an issue with my naming here, because I already have one backend torrent, which is the backend for... So once again, this is live, so I'm figuring it out live. So here it's a backend torrent, so that's a backend net, but I also have abstract backend. And this naming convention is pretty redundant, I know that, right? So yeah, I have a backend torrent, I have a backend. So I could call it torrent player, I guess. Or we could call that torrent bencode, backend bencode. But, you know, that's not what it is, so... I think that what I'm going to do is, you know, because once again here, the name of that torrent is Torrent, obviously. What I'm going to do is... while this beautiful Warcraft 2 OST is playing at the back, I hope it doesn't hurt your ears, I hope the sound is not too loud. So while we're doing that, I'll just go back here, let me go back there. Yeah. So if we go to media, yeah, okay. And there's actually a private here, okay. Yeah, not sure why this private. Yeah, probably because there's signals. Okay. Okay. So I'll just do a very quick break of 10 seconds or so. And when I'm back, I'm implementing our backend Torrent player so that Motionbox can start loading and playing Torrent really soon. I'll be right back. Hey, I'm back. Okay. So, yeah. By the way, this soundtrack is really cool. The Fallout soundtrack can get a little bit depressing, but, you know, while coding, it's a cool ambiance. So, like I said, now we're going to implement the torrent player. Let's do that. Boom. So I'm copy-pasting, obviously. Code. Just write it faster. But yeah, I think it's not going to stay that way. The naming is wrong here, but backend torrent player is a bit long and I like to keep it short. But it's pretty self-explanatory, you know. So we'll go with that first. The brainstorming here, I'm not sure I'm going to keep that actually. But anyway, let's clean a little bit our IDE there and get back to there where I'm going to add a torrent player. Oops, sorry about that. And then the private file. And then, yeah, the CPP, obviously. Woohoo! There we go. While the Monkey Island theme, that's not the main theme, but playing in the back. So let's get there. Yep. Okay. Backend torrent. Yeah. Okay. Okie dokie. So VLC is going to be torrent player. Oops. So, don't need that, obviously. Yep. And we need to get backend torrent player. That bungee head is right at the proper size here. Okay. So let's start by renaming that to backend torrent layer. And let's replace and find. As you can see, the backend VLC is pretty serious. It's a pretty good, big source file. But we're going to remove all of that. Okay, so I'm not using templates of any kind to create new classes because most of the time I like to do it by really taking attention to the details. So here, for instance, we're not on the scale. And if I use template, I'm not paying attention to the details of the way I implement each file. And so sometimes I'll just do something specific that is not easy to do if you're using template or if you're creating things extremely fast. And also, one of the things which I love is actually love the process of creating a new class, copy-pasting stuff from almost from other stuff. I love that process. I find it cool. And so I don't try to automate everything I do, mostly because if I automate everything, I don't do anything at all. And that's frustrating. I love doing stuff. you know. So let me do my rewriting here. Let's do that. Declare private there. Okay, now we know that this is not there. Yeah. So since I'm not coding generic code, since I'm not doing things generically, you know, I just most of the time copy paste everything. So here in that case, there's a bunch of things that we don't need. Also, it's a funny way to review what I did previously on this backend. As you can see, there's quite a few OpenGL code there, which I put in define. Okay. This would be like this, this. Actually, let me check here what I do. Yeah, I don't have to. I don't need to do that. Only if I have to. Okay. Never mind. Private functions. Yeah. No private function for now. Let's remove that. Yeah, clean. Backend to on player right there. Also, when you're templating everything, you still need to edit, keep it 100 column there. That proxy, I don't care about that. I don't care about anything else. Boom. There we have it. Torrent player is there, guys. Okay. Very happy to actually create this. Obviously, we're not going to get away without re-implementing the pure virtual, if there are some, and there's quite a few, the abstraction function there. When it's equal to zero at the end, I suppose you know that, the inherited class has to re-implement these. Otherwise, no good. Yeah, you have to re-implement all of that. So let's do it. Okay. Yep. It's a protected abstract implementation because only the base class can access it. So yeah, we need to implement all of this. Whoops. Hold on. Yeah, it stops there. Okay. Need to implement all of that. Yep. Boom. Okay. So here the set source. Right now, we're going to return true. Because, yeah, not ready to start implementing just now. But we need to return what he wants. Actually, we could return false for now. Oops. Because right now, nothing's implemented. And once this is implemented, we'll return the proper value. Set volume there does not need to return anything, so we can put it that way. And here, backend delete needs to return something. So there we have it. There you have it. Really simple. Really simple stuff. We're not going to need to re-implement all of that, which is perfect because. Yeah. Now, there's something that's missing there. Hold on. Where is the seek? Seek 2. Yeah. You don't have to re-implement the seek. Why wouldn't you have to? It's weird. Hold on. There's got to be a reason for that. Seek is not supported. So seek can be not supported. Yeah, okay. Hmm. I guess. So maybe, and that's the good thing about writing a new backend, maybe at one point I'll just, you know, improve the base class here, which happens when you write another class that iterates from the first. You can improve it and make sure that it works for anything you're trying to do. So yeah, so far so good. No question in the chat, so let's keep going. Yeah, so let's go there. Yep. So let's run the generate there. And let's go to sktorrent. Now I'm going to add backend torrent player. Star, everything. We want everything. And here, git. Yep. Cool. Oops. Sorry about that. SRC. Yeah. So now, this should be. This should work, actually. Basically, no such file object. Sorry. Oops. Sorry about that. So this should. Yeah. Yeah. I'm not sure how I do it. Yeah, okay. Like that, and here obviously it's going to be torrent. Abstract backend private. Yes, sir. Yes. Is the init is going to be there because I need the ignite. Yeah. Yeah, okay. Lots, we don't need that. Whoops, okay, I need to. Oh, I haven't renamed that. It's wrong. Okay. Yeah. Backend torrent player. Backend torrent player. Whoops. Okay. So, you know, the reason why I don't really like that title is that it gets really long when you append private to it. Why is he not happy about that? Protected. Should be happy about that. Okay. No, you don't need that there. Fair enough. There we go. Yep. It isn't. Actually, let's keep it. Never mind this warning. Okay, so... Oh, actually, yeah, I'm not putting it. That's weird. Okay, so that implementation obviously is not going to work, but now we have a backend torrent player that should be usable. So if I'm not mistaken, the way I'm currently using backend VLC and all these guys is a little bit special because I'm, hold on a sec. I think I'm declaring it right away. So if I go to application, the backend VLC should be something there. No. Huh. Where is this defined? Okay, let me check. Put on media. Yeah. What the? Hold on. Oops. Yeah. So it's there, so it should be defined somewhere. And controller media, okay. Okay. So yeah. In fact, this controller is only going to register this type if it's called. Fair enough. So maybe I need to do a controller torrent actually, register the type. Even though I don't think I'm going to need... Yeah, I think that's a convenient way of just declaring the type so that when then we can use it in a QML application. Yeah, I need to go over QML and the way I'm using it in the next streams. I'll do that. But anyway, so... Yeah, that should be good enough. Let's go there and let's add something like sktorrent. Whoa. Added backend torrent player. It's not really added, is it? It's created, you could say. It's added. I'm using the create term when I'm creating a new file, because I'm creating the new file and just populating the default value. I'm using the added term when I'm changing the code. That's my convention here. I'm not sure if other coders are using it on source control management, but that's what I do. So here is our little brainstorming. I'm going to leave it there for now, because maybe I'm going to reward it in some ways, because I think it's interesting. I think it's interesting. It's interesting for you to see what is my thought process and the way I work when I do something. And I think it's interesting for me, because reflecting on the way I was coding a few weeks ago is a great way to learn, actually. So, obviously, this can be good for everybody. So yeah, we did that today. It's not much, but it's cool. And so we're going to commit. Because one of the things which is important when you're a coder is do not procrastinate. Do things when you need to do them. So... Let me open another term. So yeah. I'm not sure if I've added... I think I did. Let me make sure of that. Yeah, I already did it. Okay. So yeah, that should be that. updated include files, updated media.pri. Cool. Okay, let's commit. Commit, not omit. Okay. You know what? Simple stuff there. Whoops. Simple, but not forget. Do not forget this. And we have it. There we have it. And when I'm committing, I'm not using the created. I'm using the create because that's the file inside of the torrent that does the action. And also, it's a cleaner and shorter message. Here, it's the log, so it's in the past. But here, you know, I just write it this way. Yeah. Cool. Cool. Okay, so yeah. Here's a short recap of what we did today. First of all, I've brainstormed publicly. I've shared with you my thought process when implementing something new. And I didn't cheat because I didn't look at the code before that stream. And I didn't thought really about the implementation I might be doing. So we went through a bunch of things. First of all, you know, doing a backend torrent VLC, which wasn't a good idea because it's too tied with VLC. Then we thought about doing an abstract backend VLC, but it requires base code to be rewritten. Actually, it's not an abstract backend VLC. It's an abstract backend. I'm not sure about this one anyway. Then we thought about doing a torrent backend that encapsulates a backend. So then we thought about doing a whole new kind of backend, like a new abstract backend that would be called torrent backend, that would be the abstraction base class for implementing torrent streaming in any form. But it requires redundant code to be written, and even if we're encapsulating the backend, another player backend, you know, it's not such a clean way to do it. Also, by doing a torrent backend like this, I would have to tell the declarative player specifically. If we go real quick there, I would have to tell him, you know what, here it's not going to be an abstract backend, it's going to be an abstract backend torrent. Actually, that would be more of the proper way to phrase it, abstract backend torrent. So now I need to be specific about the very fact that this player needs an abstract backend torrent. And if you give me anything else, then it's not going to work. So, you know, even when the file is not a torrent, we could have did something like, you know, if it's not a torrent, just one, and if, go to the traditional, go to the other player backend, but that's not the proper way. The proper way to do it that we found, which is fairly simple, is to do a backend torrent that is going to re-implement abstract backend, or at least the abstract functions there. And this backend is going to be the one that encapsulates the player backend and that calls it. As a result, this is a man in the middle that checks that everything is good. And when everything is good, it just calls the player backend and tells him, you know what? Go for it. You can play it. Don't think about it. I'm handling all the heavy duty related to torrent. You focus on the playback. And that's the best implementation because that's the most efficient one. Even though we're having an encapsulation there. Encapsulation is not a wrong thing to do. It's not a wrong way to do things, actually. In lots of cases, it's very good. So we're encapsulating. I could say we're just integrating another. So it's pretty much a backend that encapsulates a backend. And we'll see next time on Thursday when I'm implementing it. We'll see how this goes and hopefully it will be great. So thank you for being with me as we develop MotionBox, as we develop the torrent streaming implementation. Take really good care of you, and I'll see you guys on next Thursday. Meanwhile, don't hesitate to go check the code. Don't hesitate to post a question if you have one on the MotionBox Omega forum, and take good care of yourself.